Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and to my esteemed colleagues on the House Judiciary Committee. I was invited to offer my testimony today, perhaps because I'm a member of the PA Safe Caucus, which seeks to enact common sense gun reform laws in Pennsylvania. But I'm not anti-gun. I'm anti-violence. And violence is far older and more widespread than guns, even in the US, where there are literally more guns than people. We live in a society born of violence, violence that preceded the musket. And violence of all kinds has permeated our nation before semi-automatic weapons came to be. Violence is a virus rooted in hate, and hate is ignorance doused with deceit. And the grand deceit that has infected us is that violence, as expressed by weaponry, is the highest form of power and protection there is. We often mistakenly think the most just form of punishment is death, bodily injury, or imprisonment. Well, we have the highest level of gun ownership, gun deaths and injuries, and largest incarcerated population in the world, and we are far from safe or just. Historically and presently, too many of our laws around criminal justice are infused with hate, fear, or righteous ignorance, not healing. And we cannot ever heal ourselves without first believing that we are worthy of loving ourselves. And if we don't acknowledge what ails us, we can never become healthy. But we have to believe we are all worthy of the love that is required to heal our nation, to heal our Commonwealth, to heal our communities and our families. But the opposite of love is not hate, it's apathy. And when we look at so many people who have chosen to give up on life, on caring, so often it's people. Who have been given up upon. Society has given up on them. Our government has given up on them. People who feel loved and invested in are rarely the people we hear about when we see the latest mass shooting or corner dispute on a hot summer night where there's easier access to guns than books or fresh produce or green space. Social engagement, disengagement rather, and trauma are the twin bandits of freedom. They rob us of our potential to experience joy, meaning, and connectedness to all those things bigger than ourselves. And these things in their totality represent the abundance that life has to offer. It is what I commonly refer to as community wealth, which, as a fellow state lawmaker elected to serve in one of only a handful of commonwealths, is not lost on me. Community wealth includes so many things, but in the context of this hearing, it encompasses public safety, public health, and social belonging. When any of these three things falter, so too does our society. And when all wither, we get what has become normalized in so many neighborhoods, in cities, suburbs, and small towns across Pennsylvania. We get suicide by gun, the opioid crisis, criminalizing poverty and mental illness, and weaponized bigotry. 2 years ago this month, I was with some friends who were helping me canvass neighborhoods when I was campaigning just 2 days before I won my primary election. It was a beautiful Sunday afternoon, and we had pulled over to engage some young people on the corner of Fayette and Vernon Road. I just finished listening to a young woman who was decrying how much it pained her to see children playing in dangerous, litter-strewn, abandoned lots as we watched a young man throw a piece of plastic on the street before opening the door to his car. I approached him as the young woman watched from a distance. I had successfully encouraged him to pick up his wrapper and walk to the corner and put it in a trash bin. I thanked him, and I returned to the young woman and said that oftentimes it's how we choose to engage people that's more important than what we actually say to them. She smiled, and we parted ways, and my attention turned to my friend who was engaging another young man outside a corner store. His name was Alex Cherry. He was excitedly telling us how much he was looking forward to working with his mom at the polls on Tuesday. Alex was just 21, and I don't recall ever meeting a young man who was so openly enthused about being part of the democratic process alongside of his mother. It was a beautiful moment, and I knew I wanted to bring this young man into my orbit. I asked my friend to get his number before walking into the corner store to ask the owners if I could place a campaign poster in the window. Seconds later, I hear gunshots. I rushed outside, and I saw my friend kneeling over Alex's bloody corpse. He was shot in the head at point-blank range by another young man whose gun was an extension of his wounded humanity. Someone who thought that what he needed to do on that otherwise gorgeous Sunday afternoon, surrounded by several onlookers and surveillance cameras, was to shoot an unarmed person from behind just inches from my friend's face. Alex died instantly. His family would never be the same. My friend would never be the same, nor I. The murder made national news because Alex was shot in front of a candidate. The press had gotten it wrong, but why let the facts get in the way of a good story? After all, if it bleeds, it leads. The Monday before my primary, while still in shock, I reluctantly held a press conference. I honestly don't remember much about it other than crying throughout delivering my statement. Amid their own collective pain, the Cherry family embraced me, and I knew that while this horror would never leave me, it also gave me greater resolve to be part of the solution as a public servant. My two young sons were supposed to be with me. On that corner. But I had had the benefit of their help throughout my campaign, so I gave them the day off. But now my trauma is their trauma. The gunman has not been found, and my youngest son still worries about my safety and our family's safety. I have sought therapy and started the mourning after this tragedy, for which I wish I would no longer be recognized whenever I leave my house every single day. It is a burden I bear that is light compared to the thousands of families scarred by violence far more directly. And while gun violence is common, it is not normal. This is not about the Second Amendment, nor stopping law-abiding citizens from their rights to access guns, to own guns. This is about having the political will and the moral courage to save the lives of countless souls who simply do not have to die or live in fear or with the pain that trauma inflicts on all who are wounded by violence, whether those wounds are physical or psychological. And when people who have heard about my experience ask me, am I all right? I answer honestly, no, but I will be. I will be all right because I have chosen healing over hatred, or worse, swallowing my pain. I will be all right because I have chosen to speak publicly about my trauma when so many men in particular believe that trauma is just a fancy word for weakness. I will be all right because I believe vulnerability is a form of strength. And I will be all right because healing, not the least of which is crying openly and unapologetically, is how I will grow stronger. This too is how we as a Commonwealth must grow stronger. But we have to do it together by heeding our better angels and not succumbing to our worst personal or political fears. Thank you.
Chris, thank you very much for coming forward. So sorry to hear about your friend. Obviously, this is very difficult for you to do, but we really appreciate your coming forward with this.